Good morning, all.
Good morning.
Nice to see you here this morning. Hope you're well, and if not, hope you will be better after this service. I seriously hope you'll be better after the service. If not, I will have done all I can do. A number of announcements in your bulletins. Please have a look at them. We have sign-ups for the Fall Fellowship Festival available. The information about how to do that is there in your bulletin, and hope many of you will sign up. It would be great to see us all gather together in a more informal setting where we might just chat and connect. Vestry nominations, that process is underway, so if you know someone who you think would be interested in serving on the vestry or who would be good at it, talk to them first, and then feel free to nominate them. Blessing of the Animals, October 1st, we'll be doing that outside. And let's see, the Fellowship Dinner for Canterbury. We need volunteers and members of the parish to organize and supply dinners for our Canterburyans, which is inside baseball for the college ministry here. So lots of ways you can contribute, lots of good stuff, and hope you will avail yourself of a bit of it or all of it. Again, welcome.
Thank you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever.
Pray. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel, and so the cloud was right there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night, and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them, on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord, in the pillar of fire and cloud, looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the waters may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great works that the Lord did against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. The word of the Lord.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain. And those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own food that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in the honor of the Lord. And those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to the Lord, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to the Lord. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times, Jesus said to him. Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle his account with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have mercy with me and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into the prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in his anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Right relationship. What does it mean to be in right relationship with God, with ourselves, with others. Hold that thought. We just heard one of the core stories of our faith, the culmination of God's deliverance of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. God has answered the groaning of God's people by confronting Pharaoh, who has forced them to labor under harsh conditions. Now the Israelites are trapped between the Egyptian army and the Red Sea, terrified of what looks like their impending death. And God opens a way where there is no way, parting the Red Sea through Moses so that they might escape bondage to Pharaoh and be free to worship God as the people of God. Pharaoh is not in right relationship with anyone. Not only has he enslaved the Israelites, attempted to murder their children, and been unwilling to let them go despite great cost, but he has also sacrificed his own people in relentless pursuit that ends with his armies washed away in the waters of the Red Sea. Right relationship doesn't involve slavery, oppression, or abuse. It involves honesty, compassion, and mutual respect at the individual level and at the level of systems. God is always working toward the establishment of right relationship with all that God has created, working in love to reconcile everything to God. In his letter to the Romans, Paul describes what it means to be in right relationship with others in the church, urging them not to fight over non-essential things like dietary rules, and above all, not to judge one another. I have a little sidebar here, which is I love the line about only the weak eat vegetables. Being a meatitarian, as someone once called me, I'm all for meat, meat. End of my little sidebar. Right relationship with one another comes out of our relationship with Jesus. Paul says, we do not live to ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. Now, if those words sound familiar to you, that's because they are found in the opening anthem of the burial office of the Episcopal Church. So most funerals you will attend in this church, you will hear those words. We live to the Lord, the one who is always in right relationship with us and whose love for us gives us everything we need to be in right relationship with God and with each other. And that brings us to our gospel reading. Last week, Charlie began his sermon by saying that wherever two or three are gathered in Jesus' name, there will always be conflict. And I would say that's true whether the two or three are gathered in Jesus' name or not. We humans. In last week's gospel, we heard Jesus give instructions on what to do when someone in the church sins against us. And this week, our friend Peter asks Jesus about the loophole, what you're supposed to do if you've gone through the whole process of dealing with the conflict, reconciling it, but the person continues engaging in sinful, hurtful behavior time after time. I mean, seriously, Jesus, how many times do we keep forgiving someone if they're not willing to change their behavior? 7 times? I mean, that seems like a good biblical whole number. Surely sevenfold forgiveness is sufficient. And Jesus says 77 or 70 times 7, depending on translation. But what he means is way more than 7. In fact, don't keep count. One of my favorite commentators, David Ewart, says, Jesus is calling us to give up calculating offenses and forgivenesses, and instead to have a forgiving heart, a forgiven heart, a heart for forgiveness. Give up calculating offenses and forgivenesses. Don't use a yardstick to measure how many wrongs have been done, or how many times we've forgiven, or how much pain we're experiencing. The king in the parable Jesus uses to explain his point forgives the equivalent of 200,000 years of labor, or billions of dollars, an unimaginable debt, an unpayable debt. And the king just forgives it, erases it, because the man asks him to. He doesn't even work out a payment plan with the man who owes him, because it's not a debt that could be repaid. And then the man who has received grace goes out and insists on being repaid a much smaller debt. Note that the king does not forgive the man 77 times after that first time. He expects that the man will pass the goodwill along, pay it forward, restore right relationship with those in his debt, just as he has been restored. When the man does the opposite, then it's off to the torture chambers with him. That's Chris's favorite part. Jesus, of course, is using hyperbole to get his point across. But part of living in right relationship is not keeping track of how great a debt we're owed or how much forgiveness we've offered, because God doesn't. In the book that he wrote with his daughter about forgiveness, Archbishop Desmond Tutu says, "Forgiveness is nothing less than the way we heal the world." And then the two of them go forward to put forth a process to work through forgiveness. Forgiveness is nothing less than the way we heal the world. And we all know the world needs healing. The world needs us to live to the Lord, to follow the urging of Jesus, not counting the number of times we forgive, not judging that others have broken the rules so badly that they don't deserve forgiveness, not lashing out in anger and fear and hurt only, but participating in the difficult and world-changing work of reconciliation, and then sharing the forgiveness and love that God has given us with all whom we meet. It's what God does. It's what Jesus did. It's what we're called to do, to live in right relationship with God, with others, with ourselves. Now, let me be clear. Right relationship does not mean forgiving and forgetting. Right relationship is not forgiving an abuser and then continuing to have to endure more abuse. There is no right relationship when there is abuse. We may work to forgive because we have been forgiven, and to free our own hearts from captivity to resentment and bitterness. But the relationship cannot be restored to rightness while abuse or violence continues. Right relationship does not involve domination, violence, or oppression. Jesus did his part to restore right relationship between humanity and God. He gave everything. God forgives us a debt that we are unable to pay, and in return, or more truthfully, in gratitude, we are to forgive others when we know that we are forgiven. God doesn't expect that we're never going to sin again. God does expect that we will do our part to restore right relationship with those in our debt, that we will do our part to heal the world. So what does it mean to live in right relationship with God, with ourselves, and with the world? You tell me. Come to the table and receive the gift you've been given so freely. And then ask yourself, what is my part? What can I do to restore right relationships in my life? What is God's love and forgiveness strengthening and calling me to do? And then do that.
We believe in one God,
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father.
Common Prayer on page 392. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone. For Joe, our President, for the Congress of the United States, for the courts, our state and local leaders, and this community, the nation, and the world. For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace. For the just and proper use of your creation. For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy. For the peace and unity of the Church of God. For all who proclaim the gospel. And Michael, our presiding bishop, Susan, our bishop, Chris, Lauren, Charlie, and Jan, our clergy, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. We pray for peace, justice, reconciliation, and an end to the war in Ukraine and Russia. We pray for all refugees and for an end to conflicts around the world, especially in the Middle East, Africa, and Central America, and for all who are victims of violence. We pray for our Journey to Asylum family. We pray for those whose lives and homes have been devastated by the natural disasters, especially the earthquake in Morocco, and those killed or displaced by the floods in Libya. We pray for an end to disease, hunger, and thirst. We pray for those suffering from the destructive power of addiction. We pray for the students, faculty, and staff of William and Mary. We pray for those listed on our parish prayer list and for those whom we name now. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace. Peace.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Oh,
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself, in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. You have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace. Grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Christ.